just as far as injuries go for this practice, we got a little bit of a couple guys with sick, so LeSean McCoy and Matt Moore will practice today. Chris Jones still recovering from the calf, so he's not going to be today. Everybody else will go. And we look forward to this challenge playing the Titans. You know, they're a heck of a football team. Mike does a nice job with them. They're a good front office. So it's a good organization. And our guys will get busy this week on getting ready to play. That time, Drew.
You talked a little bit about Chris on Monday. Are you throwing curves that he might be ready for this weekend?
He's getting better. We'll see. We'll see how he does it.
Is this a situation where pain tolerance, or could he actually injure himself more or something?
That's a little question. You don't know about if he can injure himself more until he plays, but you're not putting him in that position. And he's a tough kid, so he's not going to pay for injuries.
Yeah.
However, he can play to the best of his ability. That's what he's looking for.
Andy, how valuable is your experience in these games, and how have you tried to get him?
Try to keep it as normal as we possibly can as far as the schedule goes for the players. So they get their work done and stay within the routine of how they get themselves prepared. Likewise with the coaches, as best you can without having to travel up to do press conferences and that. So I try to stick to that, but I've done that during the time. I understand. I've been there. I understand how fast the game is. I mean, I can tell you that from experience. And the magnitude of it, obviously, is every time you take a step up in the playoffs, it's obviously still single elimination, but the magnitude is bigger, I guess you'd say.
Coach, how much do you anticipate Travis Kelce being able to do?
Yeah, he'll do some work. Yeah, he'll work.
Full load, you think?
Yeah, well, I mean, today's a little bit lighter day, so see, he feels better this week than he did last week, so that's a good thing. But we'll see. We'll give him the stuff he needs done and get that work in.
Andy, I want to take you back to training camp and really when maybe the season begins, or even earlier, maybe OTA's mini camp. But the relationship, the dynamic with Daniel Sorensen and Tyrann Mathieu, I know they had to get close for a reason at training camp, sure. They play some of the positions. Just how have you seen their relationship develop as the season's gone?
Yeah, well, both of them are good guys. And I think both of them respect each other's game. They developed that. Dan probably knew more about Tyrann's, play than Tyrann knew of Dan's play. So coming into it, but I think they play off of each other well. They have good communication between them. So and then they get along most of all, and you can see that off the field also. So.
Is that one of the more enjoyable aspects of coaching? Because, like, hey, we think this guy, we work well with this guy. You don't really know until it happens. And then over the course of the season, you just see sort of deeper and deeper their appreciation of one another, their need to have one another.
Yeah, you never know until you get them here, right? Until they have a chance to bond and go through all the stuff that you have to go through to put together a team. So, and the hard work and on and off the field with the meetings and so on. So. But their personalities work well together. Dan's a fairly quiet guy. And not that Tyrann's loud or anything, but he's probably a little bit more a personality that way. So.
Coach, you want me to conclude this second year for this team? What is your message this year versus last year to the players to get to prepare for some of these games?
Yeah, so we've got an influx of new guys that weren't here. That are in pretty key positions. But my thing is preparation. You get yourself ready to go. Understand, which I think they do. I mean, these guys have been around a little bit, so understand the things I mentioned about the game being faster and any errors are exploited even more so than in the season. And then maintain your personality. And get yourself ready for a heck of a ball game.
Coach, you've been so good on special teams. You've been here, you and Rich know that Dave's track record speaks for itself. But you guys have had some problems in the Titan game in particular. got stung with some special teams problems. Of course, last year had some issues. Obviously, it's way one, do it, fix it. But has it been personnel changes? I know you had a lot of turnover on the defensive side. Has it been something that you can get your arms around as to why you've struggled?
Yeah, there are a couple things. I mean, we're working on those to make sure we get them better, and I think we'll be all right. You know, they're going to get you every once in a while. So they got us this past week, and but we came back and got them. So it was give and take. But we got to get better in some spots, and the guys are working at that. So, yeah.
Coach, what did you post last year? And you remember you saying back in camp, you could just snap your fingers and be back in this position. You had to go through the process and go through the work. Just how proud are you of the guys who work here that they went back through that process and they took care of all the small things, knowing that they're going to have to run?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, it's tough getting here once, right? And that's not an easy thing. So the ability to put all of that aside and get yourself back in the right frame of mind to do it and for the long haul in training camp and then to this point, I my hat goes off to the guys for them, the coaches. They busted their tail to put themselves in this position, and they're still busting their tail so to get ready to play against a good team. So, I'm proud of them for that. You're like Bob Uecker for about a second right there.
Whenever you're asked about Patrick and sort of the cool leadership and all that, you often refer to the baseball program. Is that something that has to be learned, or is that something that's innate? And how rare is that for a guy that's
coach? Yeah, I think it's rare. I mean, his leadership ability, his ability to the feel. I don't know if you can teach that part. You can teach the fundamentals and those things, but then they put their own personality on it. And you want to make sure that that takes place. He's done that. And then he's been able to lead. I think where that locker room growing up, where that came comes into effect, is it helps with the leadership, that he's not afraid to put it out there. And, you know, you've seen his dad and other leaders on that team, on the different teams, step up when they needed to and know that somebody's not going to laugh at you or, you know, do that type of stuff. So you got to be able to step out and do that and feel comfortable. And he's comfortable with that. And then all the wrist and throwing from different motions or different angles, I think some of that's baseball. I mean, that helps. He played a lot more baseball than he did football early, so. He knows all those release points and what he can get away with from those spots.
And just nobody you had asked, but your team's 1-8 record against the Titans. Is there a common thread through that? There's been some crazy games and some really strange bounces in those games.
Yeah. Yeah, they're all different. Heck of a record, though, isn't it? Very good. I mean, Ted was telling me about it. I normally don't keep track of those things, but Ted reminded me before I got in here that you guys would ask. So I got to do better on my end. And, my players, they've won more games than I have against them, you know, some of these guys. So it's a, you know, I'm just going to bank on them.
Andy, you mentioned the other day seeing some parallels between with Patrick's influences on the team and the offense and Tyron's influence too. I wonder if might be able to elaborate on that. What are the common denominators that they seem to bring both the room and their sides of the ball?
Yeah, they're very similar personalities, different backgrounds and all that. I mean, you know, they're different people. So, but their ability to lead men, I think, is common. They've got an easy way about them where they can analyze a situation and come to the players with clarity on it. Good communication skills. And I think both of them love to play. You know, I always joke the Badger that we just kind of unlock the cage and he makes all these funny noises, comes out and plays his tail off. But he's a tremendous communicator and loves the game. And like Patrick, he studies like crazy to make sure he gets everything down. And then he's got those instincts. So they're very similar in those areas.
Say something about both of them that they, in their first years of really playing, with a team that they can play such a prominent role in terms of their voices right away they're respected? And
yeah, there are different levels in their career, age by age and years. But I think that common denominator is that leadership and feeling comfortable in their own skin. They're not afraid to step out. They don't worry about what anybody else thinks or says or does. They know right from wrong, and however they got to that point, they know that, and so they're able to communicate that and make sure that the locker room's right. And we have other guys too that are good leaders too in there, so that very helpful.
All right, we're gonna go around the back and then we'll go down and finish in the front.
Andy, Travis mentioned kind of in game to Patrick that he made some moves off script that somehow Pat knew he was going to go there and the ball was out. That unspoken ability to just know where another guy is going to be between the two of them, do you see them work on that at times? How does that happen? Can you describe it?
We watch it every day. I mean, they work on that. There's certain plays we give them some freedom on, and when they're working in space or, you know, that. So, and they've developed that. So you give them certain guidelines and then let them put their own mark on it. So both of them have good feel for each other and how they play. So
with the angle of the knee early on, Pat, it seemed like he was a little bit slower, a little bit more tentative to go outside the pocket, scramble, and whatnot. He seems comfortable now at the 50 yards last game. Just how does that open things up a little bit more for what you guys are able to do as far as now?
Yeah. Well, it's good. I mean, that's a positive for us that you have that threat. And he's smart with it. He knows when to get down, stay up. He's good with that. I think you're right. I mean, I think he's not more willing, but he feels more comfortable, obviously, because of he had the brace and all those other things going on there. So he, I think he's more comfortable getting out there now.
Derrick Henry is an unusual physical specimen.
Who was that? I'm sorry.
Henry.
Yes. Yes. Very good.
Given his size, yep, and speed combination, who would you liken him to that you faced over the years, and what's the challenge that he presents?
Well, the guy played right there, Eddie. I mean, he and Eddie are similar size. You know, this kid might be even bigger than Eddie, but both of them were big, strong backs that could run fast. And you look at him, and you go, man, they'd be good tight ends too. So, yeah, he's a heck of a player. Good kid, too. He's really a quality kid. So, he loves to play the game.
Matt, the Titans offensively haven't shied away from using some creativity, being pretty aggressive in play calling. How do you prep for a team that's going to, you know it's going to maybe pull out a couple of trick plays a game? And, you know, is there a churning in the gut when you face a team like that? Or even if you're making a decision to do maybe a trick play on your own?
Yeah, I mean, you get to – they're going to do what they do. And so we understand that. I mean, they've got good players, and they've got a good, you know, good coordinators and a good scheme, both sides of the ball. So you know that things are going to come in that you haven't worked on. And then you've got to bank on your fundamentals and techniques and training. So that's what you do. You have a short memory, so you get in, learn from it, and then you got to move on to the next play if they get you on one. Again, you're banking that you get them on more than they get you on. So, but no, I don't sit there and that's not. You're too busy making sure that you take care of what we need to do on the offensive side. Make sure that I'm doing my head coaching responsibilities and to worry about all of that. Other than the fundamental part, make sure we're sound. You know, that's what you try to do.
Coach, after the game on Sunday, Sammy Watkins, in addition to getting credit to Mahomes and Kelsey for helping really lead the team and get the mentality right when you guys were trailing, gave a lot of credit to you and the coaching staff as well. You've been in this thing a long time. What specific experiences do you lean on from your time coaching to help, in this critical point in the season, drive your team forward?
That's a good question. I was lucky, and in my senior year in college, we played a game like that against SMU, bowl game, and we were down by a gazillion points, 3 touchdowns, 3 minutes left, and we were able to come back and win the game by 1 point, you know, and that's kind of stuck in there. I mean, I thought that was kind of crazy. This one matched it the other day, but same type of situation. So, you know, you have that, there's that hope. And then I think it's the feel of your team, and kind of you get the feel on the sideline. If you've been down there long enough, you kind of can sense what guys are thinking, where their minds are at. And I mentioned that these guys didn't flinch in that situation. There was a confidence there. Let's get right and get ourselves right. So I think as coaches, we're here to teach. So we tried to do that at that time. And the players, they were going, we don't drop balls. We catch them and we do our thing and we make plays and both sides of the ball. And that's what guys did.
Last two, Karen.
Coach, how does winning a game like that help prepare you for the next game? When you come back like that, obviously there's a confidence, but they now believe they can pretty much handle anything. And is that a good thing that you like to see with your team as you go to the next level?
I don't think it hurts. I think right now, though, preparation is the most important thing. Getting yourself ready for this team. They're all different. This team is going to give you a certain look. They kicked our tail the last time we played them, and so we got to make sure that we get ourselves right. And so that's what we're doing, and we're going to work hard at that.
Last one, maybe following up to what Ed asked about with Derrick Henry, just because he's such a unique physical specimen as an athlete, just what kind of added benefit or what can the guys take from the fact that they've already seen it, they've faced him, and there's not a lot of guys that are going to face like that?
Yeah. Yeah, they're not a lot of guys, but you're facing them this week, and so you get yourself right to play, and that's a process that you go through right now, and the most important thing, and on both sides of the ball and special teams, get in and exhaust yourself on preparation, so the mental part of it.
Mark,
okay, good.
How you doing?
How does a game like last Sunday prepare you for the next level, the bigger pressure, the bigger stage, the bigger prize at the end?
I think the biggest thing is just dealing with adversity. When you're playing in these type of football games, not everything's going to be great. You're not going to get everything the exact way you want it, but you have to find a way to win, find a way to fight. And I felt like this last game definitely prepared us with being down 24-0 of just finding a way to come out on top in the end.
Patrick, your teammates talked a lot about that speech you gave at the end of the first quarter, but they relied on that. But I'm wondering what you relied on to give that speech. And obviously, is anyone talking to you in those moments?
Yeah, I mean, people, we all kind of communicate with each other. I think that's the great thing about this team is that I'm not the only leader on this team. There's leaders all across the board, every single position group, all around the team, offense, defense, and special teams. But what I rely on is just going out there and competing. No matter what the score is, winning or losing, I'm going to give my best effort on every single play. That's how I've been. That's how I was raised. And that's how this team kind of flows.
What prompted you to feel like you needed to do
I just wanted to make sure everybody was still in the right mindset. With everything that had happened at the beginning of the game, I still felt like we were doing good things. We just weren't executing at a high enough level. So I just wanted to make sure that I kind of went to those guys and let them know that. And I think that just comes with just knowing your teammates, knowing how the game's going, and knowing how to get back on it and get back to where you need to be at.
Basically, how would you compare how you feel right now versus when you felt against the Titans back?
Yeah, I mean, definitely more comfortable. I think that's the biggest thing. Being that first game back off of the injury, you don't know exactly what to expect. You trust the trainers, you trust all the doctors who say you're good to go, but you still don't know. You haven't ran at that speed with the pads on and game speed. So definitely feel more comfortable now, kind of having the games under my belt, and been lucky enough to have been healthy late in the season.
Now you're back at the weekend of the AFC Championship. What is your kind of feeling? Anything you're trying to do differently going into this one from last season?
Yeah, I think just trying to prepare for everything. I think that's a big thing. Last year, they caught us a little off guard with the coverages that they played at the beginning of the game, and we made adjustments and were able to score points later in the game. But you want to make sure that you're just preparing for everything. You know that this is a good defense. They do a lot of different things, play a lot of man, play a lot of zone. And so you know that they're going to throw different coverages out there against you. And so just trying to prepare yourself for whatever their game plan is and trying to adjust as quickly as possible.
Patrick, what sort of difference do you think Tyron has made in his presence just with the team and in the room as opposed to necessarily his great play?
Yeah, I mean, he's a natural-born leader. I mean, that's just who he is. He doesn't have to do anything other than be himself. He goes out there every single day, and just by his attitude, his mindset, he's leading other guys. And I think that's huge when you have guys like that around the team. And, I mean, obviously his play speaks for itself, but the way he's able to just every single day be great, it really does spread throughout the team.
When you say be himself, can you just elaborate on that? What do you see in him, the traits that make him himself?
I mean, you see it in practice every single day. I mean, y'all see how he acts and how energized and how he's really going as hard as you can every single play. He does that exact same stuff at practice. And it's funny to watch. At the same time, it inspires you to be great every single day, every single play. And that's just the type of guy that he is.
Do you compete with him that way in terms of trying to have that kind of energy and bring that to?
Yeah, I mean, I always try to bring energy to practice and do those things. But I think the best thing about this team is that everybody does that. And if someone is not having the best day, we pick each other up and go out there and use feed off each other's energy. And so I think that it's great to have guys like that all throughout the team.
After last year's title game, Travis revealed that maybe you guys weren't necessarily ready for the physicality of what the Patriots brought. Different team this year. What can you do to ensure, okay, you're going to be prepared from the get-go? So maybe there isn't a
Yeah, I mean, obviously, kind of like I said earlier, I mean, you have to be prepared for everything. I mean, the Titans are a physical team. They're a team that's going to get up and challenge you at every aspect of the game, offense, defense, and special teams. And so we understand that, and we understand that it's going to be a great challenge, but we're just going to prepare ourselves to be ready for whatever's out there and execute our game plan at a high enough level.
Regarding leaving the pocket, I mean, you just seem like you're back to where you were probably going into week one. I know there were some different injuries this year where you might have gotten more tentative. Are you 100% where you were mentally, willingness to go?
Yeah, you have to be. I mean, whenever you're in the playoffs playing against these teams, these defenses that are great defenses, you have to be able to use everything that you can. And that if that calls for me scrambling, I'm going to do that. If it calls for me sitting in the pocket and making the throw, I'm going to do that. And I think that's the great thing about football is every game is different. You're going to have a different things you can do one game you can't do another game. And so last week it called for me to scramble, and now this week we'll see what it takes to win.
Patrick, this is the last week ago that one of the things that maybe not going for the home run all the time, that there's something else you can take. This game, you took off Brand. Was that an example of maybe taking it instead of trying to force one down the field? And is that something you had to kind of check yourself? With all that emotion, you're pumped up and you're pumping your fist and talking to your teammates, did you have to remind yourself that maybe the home run would get you in trouble?
Yeah, I mean, I think I've just understanding Coach Reed's game plan and knowing that the big plays are going to come and he's going to dial up the plays where you can take the shots. I think that having that experience more and more games that I really understand that more now and know that I'll obviously want to go for the big shot with all the speed and playmakers we have on the field, but just let it come to you and not try to force it.
A couple more guys. Patrick, we'll talk tomorrow, so we'll do two more, okay?
Patrick, the last game you all lost was against the Titans. What have you seen on film that makes both teams better than the last time you all played?
Yeah, I think with the Titans, I mean the physicality, determination that they play with, offensive, defense, and special teams. I mean they're going to get after it every single play. They're going to fight for every single yard. Their defense is going to fly around to the ball. They'll chase down a runner if he breaks. They're not going to give up on anything. So I think the biggest thing is just trying to match that, trying to go out there and give everything you have to in order to go out there and play a good football game and try to come out with the victory.
What did you all learn from that loss?
Yeah, I mean, obviously that they're going to fight to the end. I mean, that was the first thing. I mean, being up two scores late in the game like that, usually you're good to go and you can kind of just run out the clock. But knowing this team and their coaching staff and their players, they're going to fight to the very end no matter what.
Okay, thanks, guys. Yeah, Tyron, coming up next, guys.
All right, this is your
You know, just trying not to peak too soon. It's still early in the week, but, you know, a great opportunity to, you know, obviously play in front of Kansas City and play in front of the world and to be on this stage. I think it's everything you work for, especially myself, being in my seventh year, going through what I've gone through early in my career. You know, to be in this position, it's a blessing.
Have you found yourself like staying up late at night, you know, 2 o'clock in the morning, knowing the game that I got coming up this Sunday?
Probably not 2 o'clock, but you know, I'm up late at night right before I go to bed. I'm visualizing plays that need to be made. I'm thinking about, you know, what do the Titans like to do? You know, what's their favorite route concepts? So I'm visualizing myself Sunday, you know, being a guy that can help my team.
All right, we're going to talk to you about tackling. People. Derrick Henry's kind of a different beast than maybe anybody else in the NFL right now. You know, no defense is designed to have one-on-one tackles. So, like, how do you guys get yourself ready for bringing down guys that are hotter than anyone in history?
Yeah, man. You know, they're so big up front. I think their offensive line is, you know, really underrated. You know, they're mean, they're nasty. You know, they believe in themselves. They play together. And I think that ultimately they believe in the guy behind them. I think Henry, you know, obviously put together a great season. You know, done a lot of great things for his team, and they're really leaning on him. And I think the mentality is, you know, somebody's going to have to stop him. Somebody's going to have to make a tackle on him. If we want to get to Miami. So, you know, it's one goal, one objective to win the game. But in order to do that, we know we gotta slow down 22, no doubt.
How do you guys play the defense? How do you feel your run defense?
Yeah, I mean, like I said, he's a great back. It's hard to kind of keep those guys bottled up all game. I think the most important thing is, you know, we got to finish the game strong. You know, if you watch a lot of Derrick Henry, he gets stronger as the game goes on. His first halves, they aren't that great, but second half football, he takes off. So, you know, we gotta be well rested, hydrated, in order to kind of finish the game. You know, really try to compete against him and slow him down when it matters the most in a fourth quarter, 4 minute drive, 6 minute drive, 7 minutes left. I remember last time we played him, it was 9 minutes on the clock. They were down by 9, and they kept feeding him the ball. So, you know that they believe in him. So,
does he become more effective late because runs in a more determined fashion, or do defenders become wary of tackling or physically tired and they challenge tackle?
I think it's a combination of both. You know, like I mentioned, you know, even when they're down, they're still feeding him the ball. So, you know, it's kind of like, you know, playing basketball and your coach tell you, keep shooting. And so you build that confidence. You know that your team believes in you. And I think that's the kind of confidence they're playing with. I think that's what they're, you know, looking forward to. And it's been working well for them.
Tyron, last week, guys, we see a lot of the X's and O's, maybe the defense, but personality-wise, what's his personality?
Yeah, man, you know, he's a Christian man. A lot of faith. You know, he's a believer. And I think ultimately he believes in us. You know, I remember earlier instances in the season where, you know, we weren't necessarily playing well. He continued to be positive. Obviously, he detailed things much more. But I think he's always been about us. He's always been about his group. And I think he has a good feel for putting his guys in good positions and, you know, positions that favor their abilities the best. Well, I probably wouldn't say that. Just really miscommunication on our part. But I think no doubt we missed him. You know, made a lot of splash plays for us. So obviously Dan, I have to step up again. I thought he played well last week. And you know, anybody that's filling in for him, just understand that, you know, you're replacing a guy that made a lot of plays. So I think it's important to kind of keep that in your mind going forward, knowing that, you know, your team needs you because, you know, we counted on Juan, you know, a whole lot throughout the regular season.
Back in 15, you got hurt at the end of the year, and the team made the championship. Was that experience like having to watch that and not being able to be a part of it? Does that make you, like, maybe anticipate this one?
Yeah, man. I think back in 15, you know, being a part of that team and obviously not being able to finish, you know, it was devastating for me. You know, I really felt like, you know, I was a part of that team, and, you know, I had a certain identity within that team, and to not be out there, you can kind of, you can see it affect your team in a sense. But I think now, man, I'm so blessed, so fortunate to be healthy, to be around people that believe in me. And I think ultimately all those things has really helped me kind of take a step back, reflect on this week, and, you know, be grateful of the position that I'm in right now. Yeah, no doubt about it. He's a rookie, but he's a great receiver. I think he has a lot of potential, obviously. His production speaks for itself. I think the most important thing with him is when he catches the ball, tackle him. He's one of those guys, when he gets his hands on a ball, he can make a lot of people miss. So I think that's the part of his game that really separates him from most rookies and most wide receivers in the league. Yeah, I think this week, I think it's an emphasis on really a sense of urgency, right? You want to get out there, you want to start the game faster, you want to start the game better. Obviously, defensively, can't have any blown coverages on the first series. Got to be able to tackle and get off the field in the first series, and so I think that's our mindset. So I think it was good to kind of go down 24-0 last week, and obviously to win that game was good, but I think it, you know, it gave us some coaching points, gave us some things that we could work on, and so that's what we're going to do this week.
Tyron, I'm curious what you were going through your head when you were watching these guys play in the AFC Championship last week, probably on TV, where you were at, and you didn't know you'd be coming here. What's it like now that this is kind of something that you're finally getting a chance to do, that you've watched your team, and then you watched them probably last year, get a chance to be part of it?
Yeah, man, like I said, man, so grateful. For the opportunity to really be in this position. Obviously, I knew when I came here, it was going to be a lot of hard work to get back to this point. You know, so really not so proud of myself, but proud of everybody around me. The commitment that everybody really had, even our younger guys. I think everybody's committed, and I think the coaches are doing a great job as well. Yeah, and I think ultimately, my job isn't done, and I think being a leader, being a guy who has, you know, big picture goals, I understand that, you know, in order to really accomplish something, you gotta finish it. So I think that's my mindset to never really get caught up on, you know, being an all pro or being a leader or being a landlord. Obviously, it's good to kind of have those feelings and emotions, but I think ultimately, you know, my only job here is to finish the job. Yeah.
Thanks, everyone.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Excited, you know, just to get another opportunity. I mean, I'm sure my teammates are just as excited as I am, you know, because last year we came up short. I'm sure that everyone in the locker room is just as hungry as I am.
What lessons from last year
and
this year?
We definitely can't start out slow. I mean, obviously, last game we started out slow, but we was able to dig ourselves out of the hole. But I feel like you can't do that against every team, you know. So we just got to start out fast.
Tyreek, is overcoming adversity like last week where you guys were down 24-0, but you came back and you won by 20 points.
Yeah.
Is that kind of a result of good way to go to the next level, prepare you for the next big stage, big opponent for that trophy?
Yes, ma'am. I mean, I guess you can say that.
Sorry, the first half of the season, I recognize you missed a lot of these games. We asked you guys a lot about man-to-man defense.
Right.
We've seen a lot of it. Last week, it was almost exclusively man-to-man defense. What's led to the progress you guys have made in that gap?
Well, I feel like nobody in NFL can guard any of us. I mean, and that's no disrespect to nobody. That's just the confidence that I got, I mean, in myself and just the wideouts I got around me, including the tight ends and the running backs. I feel like no DB unit, no secondary unit, no linebacker, or any defense can guard any of us. So man-to-man is just easy for us to beat. And if you just allow us to just run through zones, it's even easier. So,
Terry, thinking about this game last year, in what ways specifically do you think you improved your own game?
Well, I feel like I'm a better blocker. You know, I feel like in order to be the best receiver in the game, you got to be able to be good at every aspect of the game. I mean, I can catch, I can run routes, I can jump with about anybody in the game, but I want to be able to block for my running backs and for my teammates. You know, I want to be able to put somebody on the ground. I want to be able, you know what I'm saying, when it's like fourth and one, I want Coach Reed to call my number and say, Tyreek, I want you to go in there and blow that linebacker up. Like I want to make plays like that for my teammates. And also, I enjoy running D-Wheel now, so that's fun, too.
How do you feel about punt returning? Do you want to be back there?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, I mean, I feel like that's how I came into the league, and that's what I'm always hold my head on, you know what I'm saying, as a punt returner. I mean, I don't call myself a return specialist, but I do enjoy doing punt return.
The special teams have had some problems. You guys had some great plays, right? Getting
right.
Into it, but you guys had some rough ones.
Right, right.
To kind of dig the hole.
I mean, I really can't just say what it is. But I mean, all I can say is that on the last game, my muff was just on me, just trying to make a play. You know, just everything just built up inside of me, just wanting to make a big play for my team. But I got to understand that this is a team game, and I got to understand that we got to go to the next play. You know, so and we got. A good offense, so I just got to understand that and just try not to make a big play every time.
The last team to beat you guys was Tennessee down there.
Right.
Crazy game. Back and forth, you guys had the lead in the fourth quarter. It was just a couple little plays didn't quite go your way. What can you take from the experience of that game this year? It's basically the same team for this
game. We just got to finish. I mean, including myself. As I go back and watch the film, I mean, I had a few key drops that on the last drive, so I just gotta look those in and just make the plays when my number is called, you know.
Is it difficult? You guys have had games where you guys dominated the time of possession. You've also had games mm-hmm. they have and you won those. Is that hard? You guys have so much confidence, you've had so much success. Is it difficult if the team is getting that running game going, which we know the Titans have done a great job of, to kind of sit there and be patient,
right,
and not try to go out and get the home run every time?
I mean, as an offense, I mean, it doesn't matter how we score. Score whether it's one play, 12 play, or 20 plays. I mean, as long as we get the job done, you know. I mean, we gonna control what we can control. Obviously, we wanna win the time of possession because that's gonna obviously keep Derrick Henry and the Titans off the field. So we're just gonna score whenever.
So when they're dominating the ball, do you find yourself getting antsy or calm yourself down?
Nah, because that gives us more time to sit on the bench and get our booties warm.
What do you admire the most about the way
Andy Reid
calls plays?
Ah, man, he's like a magician. Like when he's calling plays, even at practice, like he's like calling plays and just like drawing them up like he's like Houdini or something. It's crazy. So it's fun. I mean, he gets everyone like he gets everyone involved. You know, like so like you never know where the ball is coming because you got Sammy going on a shallow cross, or you got me going on a post. You got Kelsey going across the field. You got Mecole doing some kind of crazy route. D-Rob doing a crazy route. D-Will faking. You got all kind of crazy stuff in the mix, all of that in, and then you got an MVP quarterback. So you can do whatever you want.
And to that extent, Eric Bieniemy
right.
on the plays as well.
Right.
His contribution, obviously, you know, he's not getting a coaching gig this season going around, but, you know, him calling the plays on Sunday where you all were down 24-0, 24-7.
Right.
And then you score, you know, 40-some odd points after that.
I mean, I feel like what people fail to realize about EB is that he's a tremendous leader. You know what I'm saying? And I'm very thankful to have him in his organization. You know, he does call plays, him and Coach Reed. You know what I'm saying? I mean, they get in the office on like Sunday after the game, Mondays, Tuesdays, and they put these plays together for us. And I mean, our job is really easy. All we got to do is just go out there and run, you know? So, I mean, credit to Coach EB, man, because he does a phenomenal job each and every day. You know what I'm saying? He brings energy like every day, you know? So there's never a dull day where you don't walk through the hallways and you don't hear EB saying, famine, feast, go get it, or something like that. You know what I'm saying? Because he's always motivating all of us. I mean, even when we're down, he's motivating us. So I'm thankful to have him.
Okay, thanks, guys.
Yeah, it's going to take a lot of us, you know, hitting him and tackling him, more than one guy. He's a big guy, strong, physical, all the tools, you know, and that's why he's running, you know, wild right now. So it's going to take, you know, all of us hitting him and wrapping him up and trying to get him down.
He seems to carry, like, 5 people with him and get a few more yards after that.
Yeah.
Is there a way to keep that from happening?
Yeah, you got to just take his legs out. We talked all week to kill the engine, hit him in his thighs and his legs, chop him down. When you tackle him high, he tends to, you know, carry you for about 5 more yards. So hit him low and all legal within the game, but just, you got to just hit him lower.
Anthony, what tells you guys are in a better position now to slow him down and play better against that team than you did the last time around?
Yeah, our team's grew so much since then. We top defense in the past couple of weeks, our past 6-7 weeks, so and we've been focusing on the details of our defense. It's very detailed, and one guy miss a assignment or a gap, you can get gashed. Just like we played them last time. We hold him pretty good for 3.5 quarters, and he busts, what, a 70-yard run on us. So try not to let that happen again and play 4 quarters of great defense, and I think we'll be all right.
There's this video going around where Travis and Patrick, they're sort of thinking the same. Do you get the sense that, based on your communication this year, that maybe you and Tyron have a similar sense now where you can kind of feel for each other?
Oh, yeah, definitely. I could think of a couple plays where there were times in practice where my guy went to the flat real fast. I could just picture this last week, and he actually took my guy, and I stopped mid-play and then took his guy. It was just one of those. And then when I seen that happen, I'm like, okay, now we're kind of like playing off each other, and we're drilling and stuff like that. And we've got one mindset as a defense and pretty much as a team. So a lot of guys are thinking alike, and it's pretty much just, you know, show up and compete and get guys lined up so we all can play fast.
Is that simply reps, or do you think maybe there's a special connection, a special type of player? Like, what leads to that?
It's just reps, being around each other, playing ball. It takes a lot. That don't happen overnight. The more time you spend with each other and play in a lot of games in practice, you know, reps, every rep counts, so it just keeps building and building.
How vulnerable do you think the Titans are in terms of their reliance on Henry, that they've got to keep the game close to allow that to be the way that they function? The way to beat that is to play complementary football, explosive score on offense, mm-hmm. and force them out of
it. Yeah, I mean, that's their game plan, and they're sticking to it, and I mean, got them this far, so you know, good for them. But our job is to get 3 and outs and get the ball back to Patrick in the offense. So that's how it is. They want to try to keep the ball a game. Our job is to not let them do it. So 3 and out, get the ball back to our offense, and then keep doing it for 4 quarters.
When you watch tape of other teams defending against him, mm-hmm. later in games, do you see guys, you know, weary of tackling him, mm-hmm. or turning down the opportunity to tackle?
Yeah, you see that on film. But, I mean, we got a bunch of guys that's fit for 4 quarters, ready for this challenge. Don't get this opportunity, you know, much. So we're going to take advantage of it, play 4 quarters, and see where it takes us.
What are you guys telling yourselves after last season, the AFC Championship, period, that this week to kind of get remotivated to get the 9 feet off of that slow start like they did last year? What
Honestly, I take every week and every year is different. We play in a different team. This is a whole different, you know, team. We have a whole different team, especially on our defensive side. So we're just trying to start fast. Get everyone lined up is my job on our defensive side and let us play fast. We're not worrying about last year, last week, or how slow we started last week or any of that. So it's a new week, a new challenge, and we're just all looking forward to it.
And I can remember sitting in this room and Dick Vermeil talking about, like, the special teams touchdown teams, I think you get one. Mm-hmm. Teams win like 77%.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a great stat. You experience both. I mean, you didn't get a touchdown, but big plays going against you, big plays going for you. Mm-hmm. How much does that deflate you when you give up points in the special teams? And then how much does that blow you up when you play? It's for the guys that maybe aren't out there on special teams.
Yeah, I mean, for me, I just try to stay even keel throughout the game, big plays or not. But it definitely can help you or hurt you. People don't pay much attention to special teams, but that's huge. Field position, especially in the playoffs, getting touchdowns on special teams. And the plays we made in the kicking game last week helped us. So that's why we always want to be three phases and try to execute on all three phases.
In the style of which there
couple of weeks, and we haven't been afraid to use trick plays and mm-hmm. creativity.
Yeah.
You know, as far as the pre-snap reads that you have to do and get ready in place, how difficult is it to look for some of those plays?
Yeah, it's more of knowing your personnel, jersey numbers. Same guys are getting the same reverses and same guys are in Wildcats. So just formation recognition. Played, 17, 18 games now. There's enough on film that I can go back and watch. So it's been same guys getting reverses and same guys getting screens and same guys doing a Wildcat. So I just see certain formations and just alert my guys.
In the style of which Derrick Henry runs and how they use them, how does the amount of play action they run kind mm-hmm. of complicate that in a sense?
Yeah, that's their philosophy, and they've just been working run, 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 play action, or run, 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 boot. So we got our safeties to stay high and let the front seven control the run. There's sometimes we might have to add another guy in a box, but if you got the post or you're the high safety, you just got to stay high. Trust the rest of the guys are going to take care of the run.
Thanks.
I don't think many people are surprised that you guys are here again. People fought a lot in the game. You guys played Tennessee week 10. They won the game. Are you a little bit shocked that they're in this position, or did you see something in them that looked like they could maybe get on this kind of roll?
No, I mean, obviously we saw a good team. Like you said, I mean, I think, you know, most people assumed it was Baltimore, New England, and us kind of going to be there at the end of the year. But, you know, they're playing the best football right now. So, you know, it'd be a big challenge for us.
Did you get the sense of that game a little bit more confidence, whether it be injury or otherwise, in the offensive line and being able to step up a little bit later in the season and kind of roll that way into the postseason?
I mean, yes and no. I think, you know, he's pretty consistent with what he does, so he's always kind of helping us out in that regard. You know, it helps getting, you know, everyone back healthy, both line and, you know, skill positions and him. So, you know, pretty much everyone's been hurt in a different spot throughout the year. You know, finally got everyone back and got a few weeks together and, you know, good things happen.
Mitchell, you talked about how you want to be balanced, right? You want to run, you want to throw, but in this game, the situation dictated you had to throw. I mean, 2 minutes ago in the first half, with three carries, 1 yard. But you were still doing a great job. Andy Reid talked about how good the offensive line was. Why were you able to, when it's pretty much one-dimensional football playing, still be so sound against the Texans, a good defensive line, good defensive front?
Yeah, we knew that was, you know, our challenge going into the game. I mean, the guys they have across the line are really good players, and so, you know, pretty much across the board. I mean, it's going to be hard for teams to cover our skill guys for, you know, more than 3, 4, 5 seconds, which it is for most teams, but our guys especially. So, you know, if we're able to do our job and give Pat enough time, you know, guys will come open. So that's really always a challenge for us. You know, obviously we, you know, had a good game doing that, and so doing that again this week will be huge.
What type of challenge does Landry present?
Yeah, I mean, you know, he's playing real well for him. You know, he does a good job on the edge. I mean, they got interior guys as well. You know, I think they do a good job also working together. I mean, they got guys that can, you know, beat you individually, and then you add in the games and the twists and the stunts, and You know, some teams, maybe they got two really good guys, but they're only good at just beating guys one-on-one, and so you can scheme up a little help, or maybe the team's not as good individually, but they're better with games, but these guys are able to do both, and so, you know, it's pretty tough from our perspective.
You mentioned the injuries. How difficult is it just to not only balance the injury on the offensive line, but you've got different quarterbacks, different running backs to block for? How does it affect the job that you guys have to do up front?
For us, it doesn't really affected. You know, you block for where the quarterback is supposed to be, you know, on the given play. You block for, you know, where the hole is designed for the running back, and then from there you just go. I mean, you don't even always know what running back's in the game, so you know, it's not like you go up there and say, oh, you know, Shady's in, so we're going to block different, or something like that. You just block for kind of what the expectation is for the play, and then you react from there.
Mitchell, on ahead of Sunday's game, LDT was saying that the chemistry with Damian Williams has really evolved throughout the season as he's gotten healthier and as his offensive line's gotten healthier. How did you see that chemistry evolve even more on Sunday? Damian Williams had yet another great game, so how have you seen that grow?
Yeah, I mean, there's kind of like we were talking about with Pat and the O-line, there's, you know, the running back being able to help us out, us help him out. You know, a lot of that happens with the second level guys in terms of, you know, if a guy cuts back too early, then we're not able to get to the linebacker. Linebacker makes a play. You know, if we're kind of letting a guy get to our edge, you know, maybe that scares a running back out of a hole, forces him to cut back when he should have kept the front side, and that's on us to kind of present a cleaner picture. So, you know, I think, like you said, we've done a good job of, you know, trying to get him to the hole clean. And then, you know, after that, he's done a pretty awesome job of making guys miss and extending plays.
How's he been able to be so successful in those parts of the game? And how have you seen him grow as a running back throughout the season?
Well, I mean, he did it last year, too. And that's, you know, why we gave him the extension, because he showed the ability to do it. So, you know, I think it's always been there. It's just, I mean, the running back position, it's very kind of up and down. And, you know, obviously when guys get hurt and, you know, we're just happy he's playing awesome right now.
Mitchell, what grade would you give Eric Fisher for his celebration last week?
It was pretty awesome. People seem to like it. I don't think we're allowed to talk too much about that subject matter, so.
Mitch, can you take a game like last week and make it help you guys for this game? You know, coming back, not that you feel invincible, but you feel like you can overcome a lot in a high-pressure situation, and now it gets even more pressure. So can that help you with this one?
I'd say not really, because if we didn't already believe that, we wouldn't have been able to come back. And so, you know, if anything, it could be counterproductive where you just think too highly and you know, you don't necessarily work quite as hard throughout the week as, oh, we got this. If we, you know, something happens, we'll be okay. But, you know, I think, you know, we didn't prove anything to ourselves last week. You know, I think we always had that belief. And so, you know, just because it kind of gets the external view, that doesn't really change, you know, what we already know.
In what specific ways have you guys benefited from Andy's experience in games like this?
Yeah, I mean, it's huge. He's kind of been there and pretty much done it all. And so, you know, having him on the sideline and, you know, people have asked, you know, what was said, you know, during the first quarter, what's going on over there. And to me, the biggest thing was nothing really out of the ordinary. You know, he didn't throw a fit. No one was going crazy. We just, you know, just keep going, keep plugging. I mean, we know that, you know, we're good enough when we're playing well to, well, not necessarily put up that many points every time, but, you know, we're pretty good when we're playing well. And so, like, just gets back to the trust issue and, you know, being able to have trust in the head coach to keep believing in us, keep calling the plays that, you know, I mean, we had guys open the whole first quarter. We just weren't executing. And so, you know, he just kept giving us the awesome play calls, and obviously, you know, he's the best at that.
Good, thanks, guys. Thank you.